Perry Burnham. I came over in August of 1942 as first sergeant of headquarters, 1st Bomb Wing, H, the first heavies that arrived in England. I then went into intelligence work and was directly commissioned, assigned the 92nd Bomb Group, and joined them at Alconbury in the month of January 1943, 327th Bomb Squadron. Towards the end of the war, I stayed with the group, of course, all through Alconbury, Pottington, the Green Project down in southern France and Africa, and then returned home along about December, Christmas time of 45. So I have a long association with the 92nd Bomb Group. During the entire time that I was with the Bomb Group, a number of things happened that constitute good stories, just from the standpoint of good stories. One of the most interesting is one that happened at Alconbury. You can picture the night. It was typical of those years, black, windy, stormy. A lot of rain coming down. And about 10 o'clock, while I'm being officer of the day on the 24-hour tour, I got a phone call from the guard gate. They said, we have a gentleman here who insists that an airplane, a B-17, is ready to fly him to the Holy Land to end the war. And I said, does he have a name? Oh yes, he has a name, and he's got a suitcase, and he's certain that these arrangements have already been made. I had no notice of this at all. It was not on the schedule of events. And I called the adjutant's office from off base where he had a telephone. He said, no, we know nothing about any kind of a trip of this kind. You'd better investigate. I got in my Jeep, put my .45 on my hip, and went down to the front gate. And there, in the custody of our guard, is a gentleman in a black suit with a suitcase, a black bowler hat, and a personal card. And the card has the Star of David on it. The gentleman is from India. And he's got on all the points of the star, NH, ND, N this and N that. And I find out that this means no horses, no dogs, no cats, no children, several other things that were of special interest to him in his particular religious faith. He said, the Prime Minister of England has arranged personally with me to get on a crew, with a crew on a B-17 to fly from Alconbury straight over Germany with advance warning to the Holy Land, land over there, and end the war in meeting with German representatives. Well, of course, this meant that I had the word of this gentleman. It sounded like he was meaning what he was saying. How was I to find out just what was up? I determined that I'd have to call the Prime Minister on the telephone and find out. I placed a military call to Winston Churchill's headquarters in London. And I went through constabulary and home office and finally got to Winston's secretary and explained that we had this mission purportedly arranged by Winston himself, and that our base had no word of it at all. In fact, the weather was so bad that it would be very difficult even to take off, let alone fly over Germany with advance warning, all by ourselves, with a special crew who all had to be virgins to start with. And you can begin to see how difficult it is to get this kind of a trip organized and recognized. And the secretary listened very patiently and said to me over the telephone, sir, I cannot put you in direct contact with the Prime Minister, but let me refer you to the Chief Constable over in Cambridge for an update on this. Sounded to me like something had occurred that indicated to me, in addition, that maybe some plan was afoot. I then hung up and called the Chief Constable over at Cambridge, and the Chief Constable said, oh yes, the gentleman with the round black hat and the black coat and the suitcase and the card. Would you be so kind as to hold him there for about an hour and a half? Yes, indeed, we'll be glad to do that. And in about an hour and a half, a little black van appeared with two constables, and they took charge of this gentleman and escorted him out into the van and explained to me that he had been after the Prime Minister for months. He had a fixation that he knew alone how to end this war. And if only these directions would be followed, pick the special crew, B-17, advance notice to Germany, and fly all alone, unprotected, clear across the country to the Holy Land, we would get the war ended. And this gentleman had determined that this was the night and he was going to go. He was ready to go. They took him away and took him over to the mental health department and had an office somewhere near there where they held him, I learned later, for several weeks and let him go again. He was perfectly harmless. But you can imagine the furor everywhere occurring by long distance phone down to the Prime Minister's office about this trip to the Holy Land in the wintertime from Auchenberry Air Force Base. And I later learned another interesting thing. One of the reasons I couldn't reach the Prime Minister was because at that very time was the occasion when he met with our President Roosevelt on the battleship King George V at sea to discuss some very important developments during the war. But one of the interesting stories coming out of World War II in the 92nd Bomb Group, God praise all the people there. But I eventually retired after 34 years of service and grade of colonel, and so glad to be here with you all tonight.
I'm John Bennett, and after gunnery school in June of 1943, I joined the 92nd Bomb Group at Auchenberry and then on to Toddington. I came over as a replacement gunner, but I was given the choice due to my MOS of a 747 to join the ground crews, and which I readily accepted. And after about 26 months and about a tour of four months at Istres, France, I finally got back over here to England and processed on to America. My wife, Vi, sitting next to Colonel Furnham over there.
High school.
I was with the 26th Station Complement Squadron at Bovington.
Yeah.
I became an air traffic controller at Bovington, which I followed all through my professional working life. I became a supervisor at Cleveland Hopkins, also administrator and supervisor at Burke Lakefront Airport at Cleveland, participated in all the air shows. We monitored all the air work, and we've done quite a bit of flying. And with my wife, who is a pilot, Joyce, she is my highest priority.
You got it.
I find the 92nd Bomb Group, they were on their way from Sarasota to England at Bangor, Maine. And I was a casual officer up there and had a chemical platoon out on the lake and a little party and a picnic, et cetera, and to come back. My buddy said, you're already on the way to England, you're signed up. Colonel Sutton said we needed an armored officer. So I flew over and landed Boddington and eventually Auchenberry. I should tell you about John Knoll, the mess officer. We had another group in there, some of you people remember, and they were working on some of the bombs going on a mission, and all of a sudden one of them blew up, busted up half a dozen airplanes.
Speak up.
And we were sitting down in our area, and all of a sudden this explosion took place, and old John says, oh my God, there goes my mess hall.
Oh, no.
He now lives in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. So finished up with the group down in Istres, came back up England and came back as a casual with a fighter outfit. Stayed in the reserves 34 years and enjoyed every minute of it.